And welcome, ladies and gentlemen, to the Monastery, the open bar of the internet, the world's greatest shit show, and the place where we, the good brothers and sisters of this most holy of temples, seek enlightenment through the drunkest, craziest, most batshit ways possible. I am your one and only gaming monk, better known as Mildra, and with me, I have a newcomer to the temple, a man with 20 years of adventures within the old tactical studies research. A man behind the first science fantasy role playing game, and a man behind the illustrious Gamma World. The one and only James M. Ward. How are you doing today, man?
I'm doing good. I'm glad to be here.
thank you for coming on and braving the nightmare that is time zones.
Yes, really.
So. Now you were at TSR during the very early days. So one thing I'm curious about was before you were in with TSR, were you heavy into wargaming, or did you have a different story when it came to how you got into TSR?
Well, I met Gary in 1974. And at the time, I was teaching, and I told Gary, anytime you could afford my salary as a teacher, I'd come work for him. And so in 1980, he called me up and said, how much you making a year, Jim? I said, I'm making $9,700, Gary. He said, come on down and work for us. So in 1980, I went down and started working with TSR.
All right. Now... One of the main reasons that I asked about that I ask about the wargaming thing is in part that whole transfer between the two, but moving past that. So I not too long ago, and unfortunately this was what could be considered the lost episode. I had the director of the Lords of Blackmoor documentary on the show. So I was able to get a very in-depth look at the Blackmoor side of thing, but the Greyhawk part of it is one that I unfortunately missed out on. What can you tell me about the experiences you had working on and playing the Greyhawk games?
Okay, so when Gary Gygax made his campaign world, called it Greyhawk. Mm-hmm. He had a huge fantasy city that was Greyhawk City, and he had a huge dungeon that was Greyhawk Dungeon. So I played for a good 30 years in the city and the dungeon.
Mm-hmm. And of course, that brings me to Metamorphosis Alpha, which... Something that I noticed when I was researching TSR works outside of Dungeons and Dragons is a large amount of them were using percentile dice. And what I'm curious about when it comes to Metamorphosis, what was the impetus for its creation?
Well, I was asked by Gary to do a science fiction version of D&D, mm-hmm. and I didn't want to get in trademark troubles with D&D. So I used mainly 3d6 to get away from most of the polyhedrals. And so we made the game with that in mind. We did have a 20-sided die, but... basically, the idea was to roll mainly 3d6s, mm-hmm. or d6s in general, playing the game.
Which I definitely it's something that I find interesting when it comes to doing that approach. What was the reasoning for taking a d6 based approach? Was it just as a means to not be D&D, or was there some, or was there a different reason?
Well, I really like the numbers curve on 3d6. Mm-hmm. You know, with a lot of numbers in the middle of it, and rare numbers on the threes and the twelves, on the threes and the 18s. Plus, again, I did want to stay away from D&D. So that the trademark could be distinct from Dungeons and Dragons.
Yep. Now, when it came to Metamorphosis, was there some debate about whether or not it counts as science fiction in the early days?
So, there are some people out there that really want Traveller to be the first science fiction role-playing game. So, they wanted to call Metamorphosis Alpha a science fantasy role-playing game so that Traveller could have the renown of the first science fiction role-playing game. But we kind of put a stop to that and kind of proved that it was very... science fiction based, so it should be the first science fiction role playing game, and then Gamworld was the first apocalyptic role playing game. Mm-hmm.
And now, when it, as far as that whole debate with Traveller, ends up. For me personally, it ends up being a moot point because in my own organization, I have them in the same genre of space opera. Although when it comes to Traveler, I'm going to have to dread some stuff in the future, since I had promised if I got to 1,000 subs, I would review Traveler 5th edition. So it's not that I couldn't. It's just that's a mountain to climb. But when I did some digging, I found out that I think in a previous thing you had stated that part of the inspiration was the novel Nonstop.
That's also called Starship by Brian Lumbus.
What was it specific? Now some of my audience is not going to be familiar with that novel, but what was it specifically in that particular novel that served as the impetus?
Well, okay, it deals with a colonization starship that goes out of the solar system and it's supposed to go someplace else, but gets lost. Mm-hmm. It winds up coming right back to Earth. But the neat part, I thought, was the different levels. The higher levels had more intelligent creatures on it, and the lower levels had more dangerous creatures on it. And eventually, at the end of the book, the whole thing, all the different decks split up into giant coins that are floating around the Earth in orbit. And I just like the idea of multiple levels and multiple types of creatures in a starship.
Moving from that to get to Gamma World, was it a case of wanting to just make a post-apocalyptic affair, or were there some other inspirations that you drew from during those early days of it?
Well, we got thousands of letters, literally thousands of letters to TSR, wanting a planet-based Metamorphosis Alpha. And I was reading a lot of Holocaust books in those days. And so I said, why not make it a Holocaust thing where different societies are in control of different areas? I have read a Gold Key comic called Mighty Samson, which dealt with the same kind of topic, a destroyed Earth. So that's what I started out to build.
All right. Now, when it comes to Gamma World, one thing that's always been a bit of debate. Is the notion of whether or not it would count as post-apocalypse or post-post-apocalypse.
Right. Isn't that tomato-tomato?
Kind of. The idea with something like a post-post-apocalypse is the difference between the two is how much time has passed since the bomb dropped.
Okay, well, there's 300 years there.
Yeah, I think because the main thing is, if you look at something like, say, Fallout, the bomb is, even though it's been quite some time since the bomb dropped, and I'm using bomb as just a shorthand in this, there's still the fact that there's this attempt to try and emulate pre-war culture, whereas in the latter case, so much time has passed that new cultures have emerged that have no connection to the pre-war days. So I think Gamma World would fall into the latter category.
Well, except that they are connected through the ancients and through ancient technology. Mm-hmm. They are definitely connected, and I wanted to have people using technology from, you know, like a few years in the future. So laser weapons and ray guns and and all sorts of things like that are definitely possible in my opinion.
Yeah. Now, when it comes to Gamma World, now I had not too long ago I had reviewed the most recent edition of it. And one thing that I found interesting when I looked through how Gamma World had evolved over the years, and Metamorphosis Alpha has this with its additions to a degree, is the amount of times the main mechanics changed. And what I'm curious about is why did that end up happening where it's like in some of the early ones it was fairly close to D&D's rule set. Then it was doing the whole action control table and jumping around from different rule sets over the years.
Oh, that's a very good question. I'm responsible for editions 1 and 2. Mm-hmm. And I left TSR, and they wanted... What's happening with Gamble World is Hollywood keeps calling them up saying they want to do a movie. But they never come through. So what happens is different editions keep getting made with different designers, and each designer wants to put his own stamp on the game. So I purposely do not talk about editions 3, 4, and 5.
Yeah, it's one of those things that I found kind of amusing, because when I look at most entries and how they change between editions, there's usually a degree of consistency.
Yeah, well, that's not true with Gamworld, of course.
One thing I'm curious about, because unfortunately, by the time I found out about it, the game had already came and went. Was the attempt of TSR to try and enter the card game market with Spellfire?
Yeah, there was no attempt made. They got in there big time.
I do remember at one point Alderac tried a thing called Warlord that was trying to be a bridge between the at the time third edition of Dungeons and Dragons and card games, even calling it the game you already know how to play.
Sure, I played that game a lot.
Yeah. When it came to Spellfire, was there an impetus to try and have that same kind of bridging, or was the mindset of make it as separate from Dungeons and Dragons as they could?
No. We wanted to be connected at the neck with Dungeons and Dragons. We used all the D&D art in the first 275 cards, and we used D&D places in the different campaign worlds, and D&D heroes. So we really wanted to be connected so that people would see those things in the card game and say, hey, I know that guy, and enjoy playing because of it.
Mm-hmm. And when it came to the game, I do remember reading some old articles where people where there was that critique about using old artwork, which I understand why some people might take issue with that, but at the same time, if you've got the assets, why not use them?
TSR had the best fantasy artists in the world at that time. And the art that they were producing was amazing. So why in the world should I pay $275 for a piece of card art when I can just grab pieces from the art that we already have? So it always irritated me. That criticism of using old art was voiced mainly from the other card game companies who had to buy their art. Well, I think the art we had was wonderful and of epic quality.
Yep. Now, the other thing that I saw when it came to Spellfire was people's issues with it using different game mechanics. Was there a demand from some fans to make Spellfire's rule set as close of a mirror to Dungeons and Dragons rule set as possible, even though it's a different format?
We didn't do that at all. We set up a card game with certain parameters, and the rules reflected that. We wanted simple rules because Magic the Gathering's rules were horrible at that time. They've cleaned up their act and made them much better now, but in those days, their rules were 8-point type, impossible to read, and their deck compositions were just terrible. But we wanted to make sure we did better than them in all of those areas.
Mm-hmm. And now, for me personally, I think there's a part of me that wants to be a smart aleck and say that the reason why there were those problems in the early days of Magic is because Garfield was a math guy more than anything else.
I don't know about that. You know, it was the first game in the marketplace, yeah. So those kind of things have their own built-in complications. But they figured things out as time went on, and their releases got better and better. Spellfire was the exact same thing. One of the features that was really bad in Magic was you couldn't tell the rare cards in the old days. You had to read magazines to find out what was rare. So we decided at TSR with the Ravenloft expansion that all our rare cards would be photographs. And our employees loved dressing up in costumes, and they loved bringing stuff that looked fantasy-wise to be photographed by our expert photographer. And so you could tell a Spellfire rare card because it was a picture. And even today, those picture cards go for hundreds of dollars on the open market.
Mm-hmm. Now, personally, I never had much issue with what I saw with Spellfire, because again, unfortunately, it had already came and gone by the time I was getting into the hobby, which is unfortunate. Maybe with this whole old everything old is new again, it can be revived in all but name form, but
you'll never revive Spellfire because it was too much competition for Magic the Gathering.
Mm-hmm. But one thing that I was curious about, because I definitely played this, especially given my impetus to try and build a bridge between the burgeoning anime community and role playing communities, a thing that I'm still trying to do. Talk to me about your experience when it came to the DBZ collectible card game.
Okay, so I'm a freelancer out in the world, and I had a pretty good reputation with Spellfire sales and what Spellfire turned into. And so Dunruss called me up. They're a Texas-based company. Said we're looking to do a Dragon Ball Z licensed collectible card game, and we'd like your thoughts. So I sent them a 4-page thing on what they had to do to make a Dragon Ball Z game successful. And they liked it, and so they hired me to design the game for them, and I designed the first 4 sets.
Mm-hmm. Now, when it came to the 4 things that you told them, do you remember what some of the highlights of that were? I'm curious about the design pillars that you had at the time.
Yeah, I told them they had to have a website where people could call or could email in questions on the game. So they had to have dedicated people answering those questions. I told them they had to go to conventions and run big 100-player games. I had no problem with that.
Mm-hmm.
I told them that they had to do a marketing system similar to what Magic the Gathering did, in that they contacted the hobby stores, gave the hobby stores free cards to run games in their store, and then we had a big worldwide contest, just like Magic the Gathering did, to help promote the game. And it just went on from there.
And when it came to the active design of it, to help set this up, and let me give a bit of contrast. I remember with LucasBooks when West End was going to be making some material for actually let me rephrase that. When the whole Heir of the Empire thing was going to be head up by LucasBooks, they were the author of that was sent some of the stuff that West End had done. And when it came to the designing of the DBZ card game, was there any instance where you were sent tapes of the show in order to research, or was that just not part of the process at the time?
No, I had to watch 400 Dragon Ball Z tapes. On each tape, they had it timed from 0 minutes to 40 minutes, and the pictures that I wanted for the card game, I had to tell them the exact second that it was on the tape, and they pulled those images off the tapes for me and turned those into cards.
Did you have some notebook that just had each timestamp or something like that?
No, it was the tape itself had time set stamps from 0 to 40 minutes. So it timed every single second of the show. Mm-hmm. And all I had to do was love an image like Kakarot or Goku, and I would tell them the exact second that image was on the tape. I'd tell them the name of the tape, and then they'd pull those images for me.
All right. How would you describe the experience of designing the DBZ card game compared to the experience of designing Spellfire?
Well, I did similar things in both games. I took down the images, and I took down the themes of both Dragon Ball Z and Spellfire. Mm-hmm. And I tried to get those in the game. In Dragon Ball Z, the power number on each character was very important. So I made sure that the power numbers were a big deal in the Dragon Ball Z game. In Spellfire, the different locations of the campaign worlds were very important. So I made sure that there were location cards that showed bits of maps of the Spellfire campaign worlds that were a big deal in the game. So I tried to grab the main themes from Spellfire and the different campaign worlds, and the main theme in Dragon Ball Z, and put them in the game itself.
Now, there is one bit of controversy that happened in the days of AD&D 2nd Edition, which admittedly is the version of AD&D that I have the most experience with personally. Talk to me about the mindset behind the whole removal of assassins and half-orcs that caused a bit of controversy at the time.
Yeah, people were very irritated by that. But I have to tell you, we took a very close look at those two character classes, and they weren't fun. Assassinating characters wasn't a positive thing. In those days, we were very much into good triumphs over evil. Well, it's very hard for assassins to triumph over evil. And it's very hard for half-orcs, because everybody has this image of an orc in their head. How how barbaric and how gross and coarse they are. Mm-hmm. So playing those two characters was extremely difficult. And so we said, why fuss with this? We could just eliminate it. And I have to tell you, the game came out, they were eliminated, and we had better sales than we ever had before.
Is that it? I will admit that it's a case of absolute mad lad to print out the angry responses that you got over it.
Yeah, well, you know, people counted. We listened to our audience, our consumers in those days. And so they brought in some valid points that they were concerned about. And so I was the director of Dragon Magazine in those days. Mm-hmm. But putting it in the magazine kind of gave them their due, their time in court.
Yeah. The one part of the quote that I'd like you to help me provide some context and kind of what your mindset was at with this is, what exactly did you mean by angry mother syndrome?
Not a syndrome, it was a rule. Well, here's the deal. My editors and designers were very creative people. They were really wonderful. But they didn't know their limits. They didn't know what they could get away with and what they couldn't get away with. But we invented the angry mother rule. And the angry mother rule was this. When a mother is looking over the shoulder of her child at the books and reading text or looking at pictures, we don't put anything in there that will make them angry. So, baby skull altars, sacrificing young females, anything that would irritate a mom, we didn't want to do. And I tossed that out in a memo to all of my editors and designers, and it worked perfectly. They knew exactly how to design and where their limits were, what line they couldn't cross, and they were doing products. It, for many years, it worked just terrifically, and you'd only have to tell a designer or editor once about the angry mother rule. They knew exactly what we were talking about.
I get the feeling if TSR was located further south, you could just put up Chancellor on the wall and everybody would figure it out.
Maybe.
Because that thing doesn't miss. Ever.
Yeah, but, I quite agree.
Now, one attempt to bring people into AD&D that I found interesting, even if part of the material was very high on the cheese, is Dragon Strike. because if I recall correctly, you were one of the people in that tutorial video.
I was in the video, and I was one of the producers of the game. Yes, I was.
So, when it came to stuff like the King's Party and that, how many takes did that end up going through?
Three
takes. That's actually smaller than I thought it would be. When it came to setting that up, was it just a case of getting anybody who would be willing to jump in the office, or?
No, that was all done in California. Not any office people were in that video, except for me. Those were all licensed actors and actresses doing that.
Mm-hmm. I actually like the board game. The unfortunate thing is that video has kind of overshadowed the actual board game in a lot of people's eyes.
Well, it was a great little idea. The idea was to introduce kids, 8, 9, and 10-year-olds, into role-playing, and I think that game did it perfectly.
Yeah. Plus, if I recall correctly, there was, around that time, there was a huge thing of these elaborate adventure games that had these accompanying VHSs.
Yes, there was. Milton Bradley and Hasbro both put out those types of games. Mm-hmm.
So I remember a trivia game like approach, kind of the precursor to Scene It Nowadays called Pause, P P-A-W-S, because somebody thought they were being clever that day.
Sure.
But when it came... But when it came to, shifting from, first and second edition AD&D, what would you say were some of the learning experiences that were had at TSR?
Well, the major piece was that first edition AD&D, was written with a college level vocabulary. And second edition AD&D was written with an eighth grade vocabulary. So because it was eighth grade, it was much easier to read. People could understand the concept easier. So the organization that Zeb Cook added to the game added a lot to people learning how to play.
And it definitely would it be fair of me to say that the major driving force with a lot of the design ethos for that second edition was Zeb.
Oh yeah, Zeb Cook was the main designer. He had lots of help, but yeah, he was the main designer on the project. He did an excellent job.
What was he like in the office?
Well, all the designers were kind of I don't know if flippant is the proper word, but they were kind of kooky. Zeb had millions of Japanese robots in his cube. He really liked those robot animes. And they all read a lot. They all did a lot of good work. I mean, when you're a designer, there's a couple things for sure. If you're a designer, you're a bad speller. Kind of an automatic thing. I'm a terrible speller. If you're a designer, you're doing a lot of reading in a lot of different areas, and you like going out and talking to people. We went to a lot of conventions those years, and we spread the word about how good the game was. Hmm. And all the designers and editors were very good talkers.
Yeah. Now one thing that I found interesting when it came to researching TSR was the education department. When it came to setting that up and actually going to schools, was it an easy or a hard sell to present classroom modules to teachers?
Okay, so that's a long and ugly story. I'll try to act it for you. We decided that a good way to spread the word about role playing would be to get it in the classroom. So Don Snow, Rose Estes, and myself set up the educational department. Mm-hmm. And we actually made three different modules, a math module where you had to solve a math problem to open the doors or solve math problems to fight the creatures. And then there was an English module where you had to spell words correctly to do all the stuff. And then there's another English module where you had to correct grammar to do well in the game. And so we had these three marvelous modules all finished and ready to go. Problem is selling into the educational community. They use a whole nother bunch of distributors, and places like Texas have three old ladies that review every single piece of material that goes into the schools of Texas. So you had to get it past the three old ladies before you could get any sales at all. So it was a terrible problem distributing the game. And eventually, we found other things to do with our department. The Pick-A-Path books is what we found to do. Mm-hmm. And so we stopped doing the educational thing and started writing Pick-A-Path books.
All right, that makes sense. Now, Something else I'm curious about, because this is something that I'm sure was done a lot more back then, and it isn't being done now, even though there is organized play and there has been for years. How exactly did the tournament modules work, like the one that was done at EastCon in 1983?
I'm afraid I don't understand the question.
The maze of Zane, X A E X A.
What do you mean?
Huh?
I know what the module is.
Yeah.
I don't understand your question of how did it work.
What I'm curious about is how something like a tournament module came about at TSR.
Okay, so we again we wanted to make contests for our game so that people would come and try to one up other players in the game. Mm-hmm. And actually, the first tournament module was an AD&D module, and we had a scoring system. Let's say there's 20 encounters in the adventure. Each encounter had a certain number of points scored, depending on what you did. If you found the treasure, you got so many points. If you defeated the monster, you got so many points. If you were able to be clever and do role-playing, you got so many points. Mm-hmm. And then basically every single encounter scored you some points. At the end, each player scored so many points in the tournament, and that was their ranking.
Okay, that makes a bit more sense, because I remember hearing people talk about the module, but I was removed from the experience myself. And given how people insist so hard that there's no that especially certain camps these days, that you're not supposed to be winning when it comes to it. And then I think of a tournament the idea of a tournament module, which, since it's going to be a tournament, obviously there's going to be some degree of competitiveness. It's more of trying to rationalize the two sides of that particular debate.
Okay, so this, of course, is two different questions. In the AD&D game, there's no winning. You want to play the game and keep playing as long as you can.
Mm-hmm.
So that was the part that was no winning. But we did have winning in the tournaments. And we did that on purpose.
Yep.
And basically we wanted to, this is how the RPGA got started. We wanted to rank people. We wanted to rank them on how good a player they were. But to do that, we needed to set up tournament system, and you were in the RPGA and you knew exactly how good you were compared to everybody else, and everybody loved rising in the ranks of the tournaments.
Now, and I think with that kind of thing, because I have a bit of a background when it comes to the fighting game scene, so that's what will always immediately come to mind whenever I hear something like tournament. But having that sort of ranking, it gives, to me, I look at that and it gives people a mountain to climb. You know, it gives them a goal.
Yes.
But something that I've always been curious about, because I ended up finding about this late. In fact, I ended up discovering these particular games by pure accident, is talking about the partnership with SSI, especially when it came to stuff like Pool of Radiance.
Yeah, what would you like to know?
How did it come about? Were there disagreements about moving Dungeons and Dragons into this newfangled computer thing?
I'm actually responsible for that. I was into the Commodore 64 scene. Mm-hmm. And played those very simple text games, and I went to the corporate masters at TSR and said, "We got to have a computer game." For D&D, it's the natural thing to do. I said, "Okay, Jim, set that up and see what you can find." So I sent out inquiry letters to the 10 top companies, and we had letters come back, and we had two companies that were very positive, and basically we were interested in licensing the game and making some good cash on the side. And so we had the two companies come in and talk to us. And one company brought their head director of the company, a guy named was Joe Ubera. And he talked about how they're going to do one game a year and it'll be a real big deal. And we could make $50,000 or $60,000. And we liked that. We liked that speech. We liked his presentation. So we said, okay. And then the next weekend, we're going to have SSI come in. We kind of felt sorry for him. We really liked this first guy. And so SSI came in, and they brought six guys. They brought 10 computers. They'd already done some dungeon images and some creature images. And they promised to do four games a year and make $100,000 for us on each game. So it wasn't hard to pick those guys to do the game for us. And so we told them to do it in the Forgotten Realms because that was our most popular campaign world at the time. And they started doing the work. And what I would do then is I would review them in stages. So they'd get 3 months done. And they'd send me the images and they'd send me the different maps and dungeons, the character creation. And I would tell them what they were doing wrong. This was Chuck Krogel. He was the head of the department, just a genius creative guy. And his people were very, very well, very, very talented. And so Pool of Iranians came out of that, and it was an instant bestseller in every single format. So Commodore 64, IBM, all the different formats, they did that game in, and it sold great. And that was the first gold box game. And so they just worked their little hearts out, making game after game after game. The gold box series today is still famous. Mm-hmm. And how interesting it was and how fun it was to play. So that's how we got into doing AD&D on computers.
Which, one thing I'm curious about, because when a while back I did a research project on the early days of computer role-playing games. And something that I found out about that was around in the 1970s was the Plato system. Were you at all familiar with it around that time?
Nope, not at all. My first system was the Trash 80.
Well, it's not like I'm one to talk when it comes to first systems, because my first was those old Apple II GSs.
Oh yeah, I had one of those too.
Which, on the plus side of it, it exposed me to the works that MECC were doing, and they are still my gold standard as far as how you do an educational game.
Uh-huh.
Because, well, as much as I hate to say it, most educational games suck. And I remember somebody asked me why I think that 90% of educational games suck. And I said, well, first off, Sturgeon's Law, 90% of everything is crap. But second, they're not games. They're glorified flashcards, and that's not interesting. But maybe this is something that is something that can't be delved into completely. But what would you be able to tell me about the last days of your time in TSR? Because all that I've ever found on that matter was just disagreements. Is it something where you could tell me exactly what those disagreements were, or is that a non-disclosure thing?
That's a non-disclosure thing.
All right. Moving past that, how did you first open up communication with Troll Lord Games, and eventually start working on material for their Castles and Crusades game?
Well, I treated them like I treat all the companies I work for. I saw what they were making, and I really liked CNC Castle and Crusade. And so I checked out their website to see what they were doing on the website. And so I called up Steve Chenault and I said, Steve, I got some ideas. And I gave him some ideas that he really liked. And from that foot in the door, I started doing product for them.
And I do remember taking a look at the Towers of Adventures box set, because I will freely admit I'm a massive sucker for a box set RPGs. But when it came to the experiences with Castles and Crusades, what would you say were some of the big learning experiences working with Troll Lord?
Okay, so I have three big products with them. Of Gods and Monsters is a pantheon book of the different pantheons. And I thought of a really brilliant twist. Pantheons, and that each god gave a power to his worshippers. So Ares made his worshippers bearded fighters. Mm-hmm. Who was the pretty one? Aphrodite made her followers really good looking, increased their charisma. Mm-hmm. That was a whole book filled with different new role-playing twists. Then my masterwork, the book I'm most proud of, is called The Storyteller's Thesaurus. Basically, that's a huge book of game ideas. So if you want to design a castle, you look up castle in the thesaurus, and it gives you a ton of different castle references. Parts of castles, people who are in castles, what was done with castles. So it's an idea book in thesaurus form. I'm really proud of it. It sold great for them. For a while, it was their best-selling product. And then I really liked what we just finished, as a matter of fact. It comes out in October. Starship Warden from Metamorphosis Alpha. Mm-hmm. It's going to be a great big 680-page book for Troll Lords that details all the 17 levels and the 16 in-between levels, all the creatures and all the technology on the Starship Warden. Never been done before. I'm really proud of it as a product from the Troll Lord boys.
Now, moving a bit into some of the fiction writing that you've done. You had mentioned before that that designers are bad spellers. When it came to writing fiction between, as opposed to writing for design, what were some of the things that you had to kind of stave off in terms of things like habits?
Okay, so when I started writing the Pool of Radiance books, there were no spell checkers. So my partners were really irritated at me and how poor I spelled. They loved my story ideas, they loved how I put together characters, but they didn't appreciate my spelling. So they had to fix that for me, that's one of the reasons. And then I was a full-time TSR executive. So having the time to write was very difficult. I had to pretty much work every night after work to get chapters done. Mm-hmm. And so it took a while. I mean, I'm a much better speller now, and there's spell checkers now, thank goodness. And grammar checkers, thank goodness. And I use both of those a lot. So I've written novels since then. They've turned out pretty well, been translated into several different languages. And so I'm pretty happy with that right now. But my problem, of course, is getting people to give me checks to write novels.
When it came to some of those early fiction approaches, was there any instance where you were given them? Where there was some memo given about your spelling, or was like something sent back and said, please fix your spelling or something?
Well, that's an interesting question. There was a product called the Conan Undaunted book. It was a pick-a-back. And the author bombed out. She was assigned to do the project, said, hey, I really want to do the project. She did one chapter, and then she disappeared into the night. So they were horrified. They had a ugly deadline, and no one was an expert on Conan the Barbarian. I'd read all the books, so I knew a lot about Conan, so I wrote that book, and I finished it. They gave me a tremendously ugly deadline. I asked for 6 months, and they gave me 2 months. And so I turned it over, and the editor said, Jim, this is not good. It's just filled with too many mistakes. And I was kind of irritated at her. And lucky for me, I was her boss. I said, you know, I know I'm a bad speller. Fix it. That's why you're an editor. That's why you get paid. Make it work. But that book is one of the best-selling pick-a-path books ever, because everybody loves Conan the Barbarian.
Yeah, I do distinctly remember seeing. I think there were three Conan modules.
Conan modules different from the book, of course.
Yeah. And of course.
Problem with the Conan license, we thought it'd be a great deal to have that license. But the problem with the Conan license is, from a role-playing aspect, everybody wants to be Conan. And that's a big, big problem. We wrote him in as a third-party helper in bad times. Everybody wanted to play Conan. So it didn't sell as well as we wanted them to. Same thing with the Indiana Jones role-playing game. It was a great role-playing game. Zeb Cook designed that puppy, too. And very interesting, but everybody wanted to be Indiana Jones.
I had never gotten a hold of the TSR Indiana Jones. Like, when I think of Indiana Jones role-playing, my mind immediately goes to the game that West End had made. But I distinctly remember reading old issues of gaming magazines, and people did that thing just didn't take?
Well, when you say it didn't take, even our failures sold 30,000 units. When you say it didn't take, it didn't. We wanted it to sell 100,000, it sold 30,000.
Yeah, but maybe you can. Unfortunately, I can't. Unfortunately, if I try to find a physical copy of the thing to read through, I'm gonna be paying out the wazoo. But
yes, you are.
One criticism that I remember hearing was that the material was focused on playing the characters from the movie. Was that something that was mandated due to the license agreement, or was that something that you that was chosen?
Us to do it that way.
Ah, which getting on that now. A while back, I had Stephen Long on. And he had talked about how it was a interesting experience dealing with the estate when he was working on the Lord of the Rings RPG. Were there when it came to doing licensed material, were there some license holders who were easier to work with than others?
Oh man, pretty much all the licenses were hard to work with. The hardest one was Marvel. They wanted their characters just so. We had a guy, Jeff Butler. He was a brilliant artist. He could do a great job doing Marvel characters, but you would not believe the twitchiness that Marvel had on their images and what had to be in the images and the positioning of the ears and the look of the eyes and the physiques. They were very hard to work with. That we sold tons of Marvel role-playing games. Marvel books, but they were terrible to work with.
Yeah, I have and have enjoyed both of the Marvel games that TSR had put out, and for different reasons in both, whether it be Phase Serp with the with that whole four color set, that whole four color chart, one of the rare cases where I'm not dealing with chart hell, or the card based approach that was in the Saga game.
Yeah.
And but when so would it be fair of me to say that was there a case where there was this list of things that that the artist had to do with Marvel, or was it a case of having to go back and forth and correct things?
Oh no, we got both actually. We got big lists on what we had to do, and we had to form to the comic book code at the time, mm-hmm. which was very. And then we sent back and forth on art all the time.
So, was it a common scenario where you thought you were following all the rules, and then Marvel sends it back because something didn't match up with what they wanted?
Exactly right. Happened all the time, hundreds of times.
Oh,
Oop, are you still there?
Yeah, I'm still here. I'm trying to figure out what the heck that was. Wasn't anything on my end. I don't know what that was. I'll just chalk it up to gremlins getting at work and leave it at that.
Okay.
So one of the things that I ended up finding out that I actually had known about but didn't know you were involved with it was 77 Worlds.
Yeah, of course. I designed that game.
Now, when it came to the designing of it, what were some of the pillars that you had? I.e., what were some of the things that when you set the thing up, it's like, okay, this is what we need to follow through on.
Okay, so Stephen Lee was the concept creator on that. He works down in Florida. He's just a brilliant mind. And he had this concept, and the concept was that we have three different tourist domes on the moon. We have one that's Egyptian, one that's Roaring Twenties, and one that is Camelot, King Arthur. Mm-hmm. The aliens come and invade and try to destroy the Earth, and they get stopped. Mankind is on 77 different worlds. The aliens that we didn't know about pushes them off, all the worlds except for Earth. And so 300 years later, you are one of the members in one of those tourist domes. But you don't know that it isn't real. You think the Egyptian dome is real with Egyptian gods. You think the Camelot dome is real with dragons and orcs. And you think the Roaring Twenties is real with the gangsters and that kind of thing. But what happens is we set up the beginner set game, and I had the idea that I'd really like to do something different for guts. So I went and I begged Stefan to try a brand new experiment. The new experiment was to use a deck of cards instead of dice for all the random events during the game. And we call it the Ward system. Mm-hmm. And you can learn the game in 20 seconds. Here it is. Red cards are good, black cards are bad. When you want to hit something, you want to draw a heart or a diamond. When you want to defend against something, you draw a spade. So you're drawing cards continually in the game, and that's how the whole game is played. And now you know the game system. So you can play it too. So we did the basic set, and the basic set was on the moons. And Stefan started doing short stories for the series. All of these you can get on firesidecreations.com. There's a Facebook page for the Lost 77 Worlds and Dragon Scales. Get into Dragon Scales in a second. But he's great at supporting the product line. We have lots of products out. We went to Earth. We did a product called the Blasted Earth, mm-hmm. which is an apocalyptic world where the aliens tried to destroy the Earth, and carve it up, but they were stopped before they could finish the job. And so there's a whole set of civilizations on the blasted Earth that are interesting and fun. And then we went to Mars, and then we went to Jupiter, and now we're going out past the solar system, because the idea is to explore the 76 other worlds. So this is an idea that just keeps on giving. Brilliant. It goes on and on and on and on. We're going to have a great big 96-page product for every single 76 worlds. And that led, I just like when I told Gary, you really need a science fiction version of D&D. I told Stefan, you really need a fantasy version of this game. And so we did Dragon Scales, and Dragon Scales is the fantasy version with fantasy characters and a fantasy city called Concord. And again, it uses the deck of playing card system to play the game. And again, there's lots of products out for that now, too. And again, it has a Facebook page, and you can get it all on firesidecreations.com.
Speaking of Fireside, when you mentioned the whole thing of Dragon Scales being a case of you need to make a fantasy version of 77 worlds, was Mutazoids created through a similar kind of discussion?
No, I wasn't in on that discussion. That designer and Stefan all worked together way before me.
When it came to transitioning between the science fiction approach with 77 worlds and the fantasy approach with Dragon Scales, how easy or difficult was it to go between the two?
Oh, you know what? It was wonderfully easy. I'll tell you why. The creatures in both sets use the same stats, use the same format. So designing creatures was a dream. I use the same stats and the same format for character creation as well. So the second one, Dragon Scales, went much faster than 77 Lost Worlds, because we'd already done everything that we needed to do in the science fiction game. So it was an easy transition. I think it turned out very well. Actually, of all the games that I've invented that are out in print so far, Dragon Scales is one of my favorites.
And I suppose in a case of life imitating art, I should note, given the whole which came first debate with Traveler, apparently somebody decided to take Traveler's Cepheus engine and turn that into a fantasy game, which is something I couldn't help but find funny. And
we're ignoring phone call.
Yeah, it's well, I never claimed to have the prettiest show on the planet.
That should be an easy strip out.
Yeah, but with all that said, what would you say the future's holding? As in, what do you see yourself on, or what are you going to be working on in the future? Is it going to be, is the focus for now on expanding 77 worlds and Dragon Scales?
You know, I just put out a call to the different companies saying I wouldn't mind some more work. 77 worlds is definitely getting another expansion. Mm-hmm. And Dragon Scales already has a couple that aren't in print yet that it looked pretty good. And I've just put in an outline for a 8-adventure set for Dragon Scales that takes them all over the campaign world, the various kingdoms that are in Dragon Scales. So there's lots of product coming down the line. And, you know, role-playing is getting bigger and bigger. Mm-hmm. I think we can expect to see lots of fun things going on now. The big deal, of course, is playing games on Discord and playing games on Roll D20. Mm-hmm. I've done both of those. So who knows where that's going to go. And that could only improve as time goes on.
Now, I'm transitioning to using Fantasy Grounds personally because of the fact that I can get a better sense of control with that setup. Since my GMing style is akin to a mad scientist. I'll put it like that.
Well, I haven't tried that one yet.
Fantasy Grounds, there's a lot more that you can potentially do with it, but it is going to have a degree of a barrier to entry because of that.
Yeah.
Like it's not as pickup-y as Roll 20 is. But given the fact that I'm using a lot of non-standard games, this is the approach I have to take.
Yeah, I understand.
As a bit of a capstone, given your experience, if there's always gonna be plenty of people who are just starting out with their own role playing projects. And to those people, what would be one piece of advice you would give them given your experience with design?
Don't give up your day job.
That's definitely good advice.
We do need to make giant land before we leave.
Hmm?
We do need to mention giant lands before we leave.
When it comes to a giant, I know you're involved with that, and I'm definitely looking forward to seeing how that's going to progress. There's not a whole lot more that I can mention about giant lands that I didn't mention with Steven.
Okay.
And with that in mind, I do want to sincerely thank you once again for taking the time out of your schedule and prioritizing the temple over the phone call. And anytime you see fit to visit the temple again, the doors are always open.
Alrighty.
And of course, a sincere thanks to everybody for taking the time out of their schedule to tune in. And there'll be more insanity in our own special way, as there always is here on the open bar of the internet. But until then, on behalf of the good brothers present and not present, my name is Mildra. I am your gaming monk. Stay fucking frosty.